for being here, and to the Department of Anthropology for inviting me to be part of this colloquium series, which in itself is an inspiration. When I look at that list of names out there, it's a little bit surprising and humbling to see mine included there at all. And I think the idea of what you all are doing with this colloquium, approaching a central topic from multiple perspectives, is inspiring, and I hope you don't mind that I plan to take it back to my colleagues at UF as an idea that maybe we'll try to emulate. So I'd like to begin my talk today with this image from a recent cover of Scientific American, which posed a question that has remarkable staying power. Does race exist? Now, as you know, for more than half a century, the consensus among anthropologists and population geneticists was a resounding no. But some commentators suggest that the consensus is unraveling, and there's growing debate, especially in the biomedical sciences, about the magnitude and significance of genetic differences among racially defined groups. Yet much of the debate falters on Scientific American's very framing of the question, which can be interpreted in different ways. The implicit question on the cover, and the focus of renewed debate, is whether race exists as a natural biological division of humankind. Now, that question is important, but it's incomplete. We should also be asking, in what ways does race exist as a sociocultural phenomenon that has force in people's lives, indeed one that has biological consequences? Now, today, perhaps more than any time in recent memory, I don't have to work very hard to convince you that race has force in people's lives. The Black Lives Matter movement draws attention to the extreme but routine forms of violence that shorten the lives of black men and women, girls and boys. We recite the names of Trayvon Martin, Michael Brown, Eric Garner, Freddie Gray, Sandra Bland, the Charleston Nine, Alton Sterling, Philando Castile, and a shameful number of others. To reclaim their humanity and acknowledge the value of their lives. These cases compel us because of the overt violence and the devaluation of black life that they betray. But we should be careful not to allow police brutality and overt violence to define our understanding of racism. For the system that gives rise to such violence has a more subtle and pervasive effect on black lives every day. This effect is evident in persistent racial inequalities in sickness, health, and early death. Here, for example, you see age-adjusted death rates in the United States from 1980 to 2006. The good news is that death rates have declined for the population as a whole and for each racial and ethnic category recognized by the federal government. Yet inequities in sickness and death persist across racial lines. And the magnitude of these inequities is difficult to overstate. One group of researchers estimated that between 1940 and 1999, at least an estimated 4.3 million African Americans died prematurely relative to their white counterparts. That works out to about 88,000 people who died a year earlier than they would have if death rates for black and white Americans were equal. And these unequal death rates are not due to a single cause. We see them reflected in every leading cause of sickness and death, from birth weight and blood pressure to body mass index, certain cancers, diabetes, stroke, Alzheimer's disease, HIV/AIDS, and more. The disturbing pattern, both a scientific puzzle and a moral outrage, is that for nearly every cause of sickness and death, we find clear and consistent evidence of racial inequities. And these inequities are most troublesome when they reflect measurable differences in biological endpoints between racially defined groups, leading all too often to the circular conclusion that health disparities reflect intrinsic racial difference. So in my talk, I'd like to take up this idea in the context of my work on what some have called the puzzle of hypertension in African Americans. The first piece of the puzzle is that people in the African diaspora tend to have higher average blood pressures and higher rates of hypertension than do others in the same societies. This pattern is best documented in the United States, where hypertension or chronic high blood pressure is about 50% more common among African Americans than it is among whites, affecting roughly 4 out of every 10 adult African Americans. This trend toward higher blood pressure has also been documented in other populations in the African diaspora, including in Britain, Brazil, Bolivia, and many parts of the Caribbean. As a rule, the burden of high blood pressure is not as great in other African-derived populations as it is in the United States, but a pattern of elevated blood pressure is clear nonetheless. And this pattern is significant, first of all, because of its public health impact. As a major cause of heart disease, kidney failure, and stroke, high blood pressure is to blame for at least 15% of the premature mortality experienced by African Americans. That's more than any other cause of death, including diabetes, cancer, HIV/AIDS, or homicide. Hypertension also takes its toll in Latin America and the Caribbean, where heart disease, stroke, and kidney failure are among the leading causes of death and on the rise. A second reason that this puzzle is significant is that generations of attempts to solve it have started from the assumption that some intrinsic racial genetic difference is at the root of the problem. This assumption is reflected in the language of many reports in the biomedical literature. Take, for example, Langford's 1981 paper in the Postgraduate Medical Journal, Is Blood Pressure Different in Black People? Or Sadat's 1996 paper in the Journal of Human Hypertension, Is the Pathogenesis of Hypertension Different in Black Patients? Or Brewster and colleagues' more recent paper, which implies that the only open question is which genetic factor is responsible for excess hypertension, not whether it is primarily a genetic factor. The same assumptions about race, genes, and disease continue into the present. Consider, for example, a recent review article in the journal Current Opinions in Nephrology and Hypertension. The authors of this review concede that the genetic basis of hypertension remains largely unknown. And yet, they are still willing to assert that racial inequalities in hypertension are largely genetic in origin. They write that relative to European Americans, African Americans more often manifest salt sensitivity with expanded plasma volume and suppressed plasma renin activity, non-dipping phenotypes, albuminuria, and end-stage renal disease. These factors support an inherited basis for disease. Now, the logical flaw here, as I'm sure you recognize even thinking back to your high school biology, is that the researchers have inferred a genetic cause based only on differences in phenotype, the observable biological trait. And we have known, at least since Mendel, that such inferences are unwarranted, even for traits as simple as the height or color of garden peas, not to mention complex phenotypes like blood pressure. It remains an open question, then, to what extent the phenotypic differences these authors observe are attributable to genes, to environments, or to interactions between them. And the available evidence, by the way, undermines the assumption that genes have much to do with it at all. Researchers have spent incredible sums of taxpayer money searching for genetic contributors to racial inequalities in health. And a recent systematic review of research on cardiovascular disease in particular showed that this effort has been for naught. Kaufman and colleagues write that despite the rapid increase in the number of genomic studies over the past decade that covered many outcomes, the accumulated evidence for a genetic contribution to cardiovascular disease disparities in blacks versus whites has been essentially nil. Nevertheless, the assumption that there are racial genetic differences in predisposition to high blood pressure persists, and it has pernicious effects on the practice of biomedical research. As one example, consider a study by Tang and colleagues in which the goal was to test for associations between individual level estimates of genetic ancestry, described here as racial admixture, and two health outcomes, body mass index and blood pressure, in African Americans and Mexican Americans in the Family Blood Pressure Program study. The researchers conclude that their results are, quote, suggestive of genetic differences between Africans and non-Africans that influence blood pressure, but such effects are likely to be modest compared to environmental ones. Now, the second part of this sentence is correct, but the first is not, for two reasons. First, the study actually produced no statistically significant evidence of an association between African ancestry and blood pressure, so the inference that such a difference exists clearly reaches beyond the data. Second, the study illustrates a more pervasive and pernicious problem in the role of race in biomedical research. In particular, the study examines the association between two biological parameters, genetic ancestry and blood pressure. And if they observe an association between these two biological attributes, they attribute it to some susceptibility alleles, or genetic variants linked both to African genetic ancestry and to blood pressure. But they haven't identified any such alleles, and so they have no evidence to support the inference that if an association exists between ancestry and blood pressure, it's because of a genetic cause. And, of course, another interpretation is possible. It could also be that the relationship between these two biological parameters is entirely mediated through experience. If being a person of African descent shapes the life experiences and exposures one has in a racially structured society, and it surely does, then genetic ancestry could be associated with blood pressure through sociocultural processes involving exposure to discrimination, poverty, and social stressors linked to systemic racism. Now, I was ranting about this several years ago in one of my graduate seminars, as I'm prone to do. And then graduate student Amy Nahn, who's now a professor at UCSD, pointed out during my office hours later that week that the data set Tang and colleagues analyzed in this study is publicly available. Our tax funds paid for it, and so we all have access to it. So she downloaded it and discovered that the data set included a simple measure of educational attainment. Now, no one would suggest that this measure even begins to capture the range of experiences and exposures linked to African ancestry in a racially stratified society, but it still turns out to explain blood pressure variation better than genetic ancestry does. In particular, as you see on the left, when we ignore education, we replicate Tang and colleagues' suggestive evidence for an association between African ancestry and blood pressure. But then when we include education in the model, African ancestry loses its explanatory power, and it turns out that each additional year of education that one attains is associated with about a half a millimeter mercury reduction in blood pressure. This evidence then clearly supports the primacy of social determinants of racial inequalities in health in a parsimonious way that requires few additional assumptions. It also gets us thinking about the way that researchers across disciplines, from the social sciences to the biomedical sciences, often use the concept of race without specifying their meaning, and that often we talk past one another because we fail to distinguish between an understanding of race as some component of genetic ancestry, which is frighteningly common still in biomedical research, as compared to the social scientist's understanding of race as a form of social classification embedded in historical, political, and economic circumstances. Now, one thrust of my research, beginning with my work in Puerto Rico, has been to try to distinguish more clearly between these two different dimensions of the race concept, between the biological and the cultural. My work in Puerto Rico derived from the fact that the ethnographic record made clear that the meaning of skin color was different on the island than it is in the United States, and it's different in particular in a way that makes it possible for us to consider people who appear to have the same phenotype, who have the same skin color, for example, but who are placed into different social categories because of other physical features or because of other status markers like residence or occupation or family background. So I set out then to try to disentangle the cultural and biological dimensions of skin color and of ancestry and determine which was a better predictor of blood pressure variation. And the punchline from this work is that the cultural ascription of color, literally color, but it carries some other ideas as well, is associated with blood pressure, but neither skin color nor genetic ancestry are. Now, to give you just some quick sense of how I arrived at this punchline, I arrived in Puerto Rico as a naive North American white social scientist, like plenty before me, and I began asking questions about race. And finally, a friend of mine, whom I'll call Maria, said to me when I was sitting in her shop one day, "Here there are no divisions of race, of raza, but there are divisions of color." And I said, "Okay, explain to me what you mean then." And she said, "Well, here when we talk about la raza puertorriqueña, the Puerto Rican race, we're talking about our sense of national identity, which is a combination of European, Taino, and African roots, usually in that order. And we all identify ourselves then as part of the same raza, but within that raza there are differences of color. And I set about then in the ethnography then to try to understand what those differences were and how they played into people's everyday lives. And time doesn't allow me to get into that in too much detail, but I'll refer you to this one particular finding, which came from a replication of Marvin Harris's work on the Brazilian racial calculus in the 1960s and 70s. And among other things, I used the standardized facial portraits that he had developed in Brazil, which vary systematically in skin tone and hair texture and facial features, and I asked people simply to group them into the piles that they thought went together. What you're seeing here is an aggregate representation of how people sorted these cards using a technique called multidimensional scaling. And what it shows that's relevant for debates about blood pressure is that ideas about color are not just about color, it's equally about hair form. And this means that it's possible to isolate folks who have the same skin tone, but who vary in other phenotypic features, or who vary in social status markers and could therefore be placed into different social categories. So that was about understanding race as a form of social classification. But we also wanted to address the assumption that persists among some biomedical researchers that what we call race is capturing something about genetic ancestry. And so I began a collaboration with my colleague at the University of Florida, Connie Mulligan, who's a geneticist in our department, so that we measured so-called ancestry informative markers, or AIMS. And these are genetic markers that have large frequency differences between putative ancestral populations like Europeans and Africans and Amerindians. And there are a whole lot of problematic assumptions built into this, but I won't get into that now, because our goal was to say, okay, if we do what the human geneticists do, what do we find? In addition, we took that next step that the other researchers I told you about a moment ago did not do, which was we looked at some susceptibility alleles. And in that particular study, we've looked at 6 polymorphisms in 3 genes in the adrenergic receptor family. And if you don't know what I'm talking about right now, don't worry about it. The biology of that's not crucial for the argument that I'm building right now. What is crucial is first this result, which shows the association between our DNA-based estimates of West African ancestry along the vertical axis and 3 culturally meaningful categories of color, using a measure that was ethnographically grounded in a way that tried to estimate how people would be perceived by other Puerto Ricans in everyday life. And in many ways, this result confirms the basic anthropological critique of race, because it shows that culturally constructed categories like color in Puerto Rico or race in the United States are not good predictors of genetic ancestry. There is a trend, as you would expect, higher levels of African ancestry as you move from blanco or white to rieño, this intermediate category that literally means wheat-colored, to negro or black. But most striking is the amount of overlap in genetic ancestry across these categories, that there are some levels of African ancestry where, despite that DNA-based estimate of ancestry, people could be placed into any one of these 3 categories. So we can't make inferences about genetic ancestry from these culturally constructed categories, nor the other way around. And this pattern then does set up the possibility of saying, well, which of these 2 variables is a better predictor of blood pressure variation? Is it genetic ancestry, or is it the way that people identify themselves and are identified by others in the course of everyday life? And the answer is the latter, that the cultural ascription of color, especially through an interaction with socioeconomic status, which we measured as a combination of income and education, predicts blood pressure variation, but genetic ancestry does not. Now, here again, I'm showing you 2 different models. The first one on the left only tests whether African ancestry is associated with blood pressure. And if we ignore the sociocultural variables, as tends to happen in biomedical research, it appears that higher levels of African ancestry are associated with higher levels of blood pressure. But that finding holds only if we ignore the sociocultural variables. If we consider class and color and the interaction between them, then evidence for an effect of genetic ancestry evaporates, and what turns out instead is that the interaction between class and color is more strongly associated with blood pressure. And it's associated in this way in particular, so that for Puerto Ricans whom we estimate are perceived by others as blanco and rieño, as their socioeconomic status increases, their blood pressure decreases, the pattern that we're used to seeing in industrialized societies. But for Puerto Ricans who are perceived by others as negro or black, as their socioeconomic status increases, so too does their blood pressure. Now, in this study, we don't have ample data to test the mechanisms precisely. But from the ethnography, it stands to reason that what we see here indicates the social stress process that is associated especially with the people in the upper right-hand quadrant of this graph. As one of the participants in my study said, these are effectively negros living in a world of blancos. They're dark-skinned Puerto Ricans who inhabit social contexts that have historically been dominated by light-skinned Puerto Ricans. And as a consequence, those people are more likely in their everyday lives to bump up against institutional and interpersonal discrimination in ways that get under the skin, become embodied in a range of outcomes, including sustained blood pressure, high blood pressure. One of the participants in my study, Doña Mercedes, said it this way when I asked her to explain to me how racism operates in the island. She said, "You don't see it much among the poor, but among those who are better off economically, you see a lot of racism because they often reject people beneath them." Now, before we all collectively celebrate the triumph of nurture over nature, let me point out an important nuance here, which was that when we included the sociocultural variables in our analysis, it also revealed a genetic association with blood pressure that previously we did not see. Again, on the left-hand side, when we only include African ancestry and these two candidate genes for blood pressure, it does not appear that those candidate genes for high blood pressure are associated with blood pressure. But when we include class, color, and the interaction between them in the model, now suddenly we do have evidence that those candidate genes are associated with blood pressure. And if you think about it for a moment, this actually makes a lot of sense. We all learned in high school that phenotype is the product of genotype and environment. It stands to reason then that the better we characterize the environment, including the way that that environment is structured by racism, then the more able we may be to detect genetic associations where they exist. So the point is not that genes are irrelevant. The point is that those genes are not patterned along racial lines. And that when we take account for how race works as a sociocultural phenomenon, we're better able to understand how the biology actually works. Okay, let me take you now from the Caribbean to sunny Florida, where for about the last decade, colleagues and I have continued to pursue this work in the capital of Florida, Tallahassee. Now, if you haven't been to Tallahassee before, set aside any preconceptions that you have about Florida. Tallahassee is more known for moss-covered oak trees than for sun-kissed palms, and it is just far enough north to be part of the Deep South. In fact, few people realize that Tallahassee was the site of only the third bus boycott in 1956, after Selma and Montgomery, and by some historians' accounts, it was the most successful of the three. That spirit of civil rights activism remains alive and well in Tallahassee in a way that distinguishes it from the rest of the state. And in this context, I co-founded, along with Ms. Maisha Mitchell, a community organizer born and raised in Tallahassee, the Health Equity Alliance of Tallahassee, or HEAT. HEAT is a community academic partnership grounded in principles of community-based participatory research, and it strives to build equitable partnerships between researchers like me, community members and organizers, and policymakers, so that we're able to bridge the gap between research and action to both explain and eliminate racial inequalities in health. One of our key projects has been HEAT Heart Health, which is a mixed methods study that began with an exploratory ethnographic phase using conventional ethnographic methods, as well as specialized techniques of cultural domain analysis and personal network analysis to arrive at culturally relevant measures of social stressors, including exposure to stressors related to racism. We then built on that phase with a community-based epidemiologic survey using a multi-stage probability sample of 178 African-American adults ages 25 to 65, in which we measured a range of health outcomes, social stressors, and characteristics of people's personal networks. Now, this study makes three contributions to science. The first is that despite the availability of now more than two dozen measures for assessing people's exposure to discrimination, none of those measures were developed by collecting people's stories about how they actually experience race and racism. So by building our measures on the ethnography, we have measures that tap into the meaningful parts of people's experience in ways that I think capture more of that experience, as I'll show you in a moment. Second is that we've introduced large sample measures of people's personal networks. That is, measures about the composition and structure of the web of social relations in which people are embedded. And we've integrated a range of stress biomarkers and expanded on the genetic analyses that we initiated in the work in Puerto Rico. Now, I want to focus on one set of findings that brings together these three contributions of the study, and that concerns the concept of vicarious racism. Now, briefly, vicarious racism refers to the secondary experience of interpersonal and institutional racism through the actions, feelings, and experiences of others, rather than through direct experience. I would argue that vicarious racism is a potentially important but largely overlooked contributor to racial inequalities in health and to our broader understanding of the social stress process and everyday racism. Now, here's one example of this pattern from our ethnographic interviews. It comes from an interview with a young African-American woman with a high school education who works as a secretary. And when asked to talk about a time she was treated differently because of race, she answered not with a story of her own, but with a story of a coworker. She says, "Some white people try to get under your skin so you can argue with them. Like, for instance, one of my coworkers had some long braids in her hair. So this white nurse pulls up a picture of a Doberman dog on the computer and tells her, 'Oh, this is what you look like,' to her face. And I'm the type of person, I'm sorry, if you talk about her, you're talking about me, because I'm black." Now, this excerpt is striking not just for how horrible it is on the face of it, but also for the way that this woman empathizes with her coworker's experience and takes it on as her own because of a shared racial identity. The implication of her comment, "If you talk about her, you're talking about me," is that she may experience any episode of racism in a personal way, even if she is not the direct target or victim of that episode. These kinds of stories were astonishingly frequent. Overall, in our sample, the theme of vicarious racism appeared in 73% of the ethnographic interviews, and informants were more likely to narrate others' experiences of racism in these open-ended interviews if, in the subsequent personal network elicitation, which I'll show you in a moment, they also reported a higher percentage of alters, that is, members of their network, who had spoken to them about experiences of racism. So to give you some sense of the network data here, I'm showing you two participants from this ethnographic phase of our work. I'll call them Willie and Sheila. And these are visualizations of their networks. Each symbol that you see here is a person that they know. If there's a line connecting those symbols, then it means that those two people also know each other. The triangles are men, the circles are women, and the shading of the symbols reflects Willie and Sheila's perception of those people's race. And what you can see is that Willie has a densely knit network. In fact, when we showed him this picture at the end of the interview and asked him to help us figure out what it means, he said, "Looks like we're going to be all right. Everybody's going to stick together." And this could, in fact, be one consequence of a network structure like this. However, it could also be the kind of network structure that results from race-based residential segregation and keeps Willie and his network closed off from valued social and economic resources that can't come in because everybody is so densely knit. By contrast, Sheila is a professor and works at a historically white university, and so you can see in the upper right-hand part of her network all of those open symbols. Those are her colleagues, so she works in a white public space. To the bottom right, you see family and church members. To the left-hand side, you see a distributed network of colleagues in the same academic discipline, but at different universities. And so you can imagine the differences in the ways that Willie and Sheila move through the world experiencing race differently because of those around them. We also asked for each one of these networks if the 35 people that we asked people to name had ever shared with our respondent some example of experiencing racism. And the results there were all over the place, ranging from 0% of those people ever talking about racism to 94%, with an average of about 42%. This suggests that when we only ask about ways that individuals are treated unfairly because of race, that we are vastly underestimating the kinds of exposures that people are getting, because it's coming at them, in many cases, through their personal networks, through the people that they know. It also turns out that the higher the household income, the greater the percentage of people in one's network who have shared some experience of racism with you. And this pattern could help to explain why we see the kind of interaction that we did between class and color in Puerto Rico and others have observed in the United States as well, showing that in many cases, for many health outcomes, the black-white gaps are actually highest at higher levels of socioeconomic status. And this graph is a suggestive hint of part of the social dynamics that may be going on there. Now, based on the ethnographic emergence of this concept of vicarious racism, we tried to operationalize it in two ways in the survey, both a set of standard survey questions and by continuing the network elicitation. And the simplest way that we tried to measure vicarious racism was to take the most commonly used measure of exposure to discrimination, a measure developed by the sociologist David Williams and his colleagues. And that measure normally asks for each participant, have you ever been treated unfairly in a range of social context? And based on the ethnography, we made a simple tweak where we said, have you or someone close to you ever been treated unfairly? And if people said yes, then we probed to find out who that person was. It turns out that in our sample, 82% of respondents reported that they or someone close to them had experienced unfair treatment. And fully 22% of our sample, more than a fifth of the people we interviewed, denied that they had ever been treated unfairly, but they acknowledged that someone close to them had been. This suggests that the existing research based on self-reports of discrimination is vastly underestimating the range of exposures that people have. And in two separate analyses now, we have shown that this measure of unfair treatment to others is more consistently predictive of blood pressure than is a measure of direct one's own experience of blood pressure. So I'm showing you here, for the sake of time, only the most recent of these analyses, which NPR summed up in plainer words than I'm using now. They seized on the key idea that knowing someone who faced discrimination may affect blood pressure. Now, here I'm showing you results of the genetic association analysis for systolic blood pressure on the left and diastolic blood pressure on the right. And each one of these dots is a single nucleotide polymorphism, or a SNP. On the top row is interactions between those genetic variants and self-reported discrimination, unfair treatment to self. And on the bottom, we have the interaction between those genetic variants and unfair treatment to others, our measure of vicarious racism here. And two things jump out. First is that we have more interactions for unfair treatment to others than we do for unfair treatment to self. And moreover, it turns out that these genetic variants suggest that there are different biological pathways from the self-experience of the direct experience of racism to blood pressure as compared to vicarious experiences of racism to blood pressure. In particular, for the measure of unfair treatment to self, the genetic variant had previously been associated with serum metabolites in African Americans. This is an outcome related to heart disease. But the three genetic variants that popped up in our analysis of vicarious racism had never been associated with blood pressure before. Instead, they had been associated with anxiety and depression and suicide, mood-related disorders, suggesting different biological pathways collecting the dots. Now, why would this be? Why would unfair treatment to others be more consistently predictive of blood pressure variation than is the direct experience of discrimination? And why might it operate through different biological pathways? Well, there are several possible answers, but in the time I have left, I want to focus on what we can learn from the ethnography. And I'll consider the case of one particular woman whose experience may help us interpret the pattern and generate hypotheses for future research. This comes from an interview with a woman I'll call Deanna, a 23-year-old dark-skinned African-American woman with a master's degree. She grew up in South Florida, but came to Tallahassee for school and has stayed put for now. And when asked about the ways that people in her network had experienced racism, this young woman answers with four well-defined cases from her grandparents, her boyfriend, and a close friend. And she narrates these experiences with assurance, revealing no doubt about whether they constituted examples of racism. She regards other stories as valid and unambiguous. And she's clear about the impact of this vicarious experience. It's very aggravating, she says. It's upsetting, because then you have to go out and deal with that. But she takes a strikingly different tone when asked about her own experiences. Here, she hesitates, she searches for examples, and finally says, "I don't think I've ever really had an experience where I thought people were just being racist." She gives others the benefit of the doubt, interpreting their behavior not as racism, but as a reflection of the stresses in their lives or as personality quirks. She also makes explicit that this approach, not calling it, unless she can really call it, is a coping strategy. I don't want to get upset. Thus, she doubts her own experience of racism, even distances herself from it, but regards the experience of others as legitimate. Her vicarious experience of racism is unambiguous. Her direct experience of it is not. Moreover, she turns to her own network to legitimate her personal experiences. If friends or family are nearby when she thinks she may have been treated differently because she's black, she may ask them, "Did you notice that? Or was it just me?" This contrast is significant because, first, it shows precisely how racism is socially constructed. The meaning of social interaction, whether it is an example of racism or not, is not given in nature. Rather, that meaning is co-constructed through intersubjective agreement about how to interpret an act or event. Deanna holds other stories as prototypes for what racism is, and turns to those same others to determine what her direct experience means. Cultural meaning is thus co-created in personal networks. Social network processes thus likely play a key role in the pathway from systemic racism to poor health related to the social stress process. As Deanna's case shows, sharing stories of racism in one's personal network helps to shape one's understanding of what racism means. And it works as, and because it's a form of seeking and providing social support, it's also a means of coping with the stress of that experience. But vicarious racism is likely to be uniquely threatening to the extent that it alters your perception of how much injustice exists in the society, to the extent that empathy with others constitutes a kind of indirect trauma, and to the extent that it puts you on high alert when you venture out into social contexts where you know that others have been treated unfairly. What's more, the options for coping with this kind of stress are diminished as compared to ways of coping with direct experiences of racism, when you, like Deanna, can decide whether to call it or not. Vicarious racism, by contrast, doesn't offer the same option and may prime you to respond with empathy and to validate others' experiences. In so doing, it alters your understanding of the social world and the threats you may face. And this, of course, is to speak only of network-mediated exposure to vicarious racism that we've been able to measure in our work so far. In fact, this measure likely vastly underestimates the true exposures, as our participants taught us. In this particular case, a young woman recounts a moment where, confronted with the police, and this was not long after the Sean Bell killing, that she sees it all the time, she hears about it all the time, so around that time she was fed up. "I was angry," she said. "I'm not angry anymore, but I don't trust the police anymore." And of course, in the intervening years, many commentators have observed that the viral spread of images and stories about police brutality and Black death result in profoundly stressful experiences for people who identify themselves as potential victims of the same kind of violence. Okay, let me end by reconsidering the question that Scientific American posed on its cover. I asserted at the beginning that this question falters because it can be interpreted in different ways. People understand race to mean different things, and so researchers in different disciplines often talk past one another. About a decade ago, the anthropologists Ken Weiss and Stephanie Fullerton offered a fitting metaphor to describe the situation. The issue of race, they said, continues to cycle endlessly like blinkered horses in old country fair merry-go-rounds, oblivious to the fact that they're just going round and round. So how do we stop the spinning? One basic intervention would be to develop more precision in what we mean when we talk about race and to open up the possibility for conversation across disciplines, notably from the social sciences to the biomedical ones. But to stop the spinning for good, I would suggest that we need to devote as much attention to the meaning of biology as we have to the meaning of race. Here is one of the central challenges we face. Epidemiologic evidence shows that in a very certain sense, race is biology. There are, in fact, well-defined differences between racially defined groups for a range of biological outcomes: cardiovascular disease, diabetes, renal failure, cancer, stroke, and birth outcomes, to name a few. In the face of this evidence, the refrain that race is not biology is impotent at best and counterproductive at worst. Our challenge then is to move beyond the pat assertion that race is not biology and explain how race becomes biology. Now, some of you may find yourselves shifting in your seats as I talk about racial differences in biology. You may worry, with good cause, that such talk reinforces the perception of intrinsic genetic differences between alleged races. This well-founded concern is important, in part because it reveals just how deeply entrenched the twin assumptions of reductionism and genetic determinism are in our understanding of race in particular, and biology in general. The idea that it's politically dangerous to discuss biological differences among racialized groups makes sense only if we or our audience implicitly reduce biology to genetics and minimize or ignore the causal influence of external environmental factors on human biology. What's more, the tacit conflation of genes and biologies in the conventional anthropological critique of race unwittingly perpetuates this form of reductionism. This focus on human biology as a biocultural phenomenon also requires us to rethink the other part of social scientists' usual mantra that race is a cultural construct. Many social scientists repeat this mantra in response to the resurgence of racial thinking. But this response is ineffective because the claim that race is culturally constructed is largely irrelevant to evaluating whether racial categories correspond to human genetic variation. Think about it. The usual formulation of social scientists' position implies a contrast between mutually exclusive alternatives. Race is either a cultural construct or a biological phenomenon. In fact, there is no logical contradiction between the claim that race is a cultural construct and the claim that it's a useful way to understand human genetic variation. These two claims simply address different types of phenomena and require different types of data. The only way to assess the truth value of claims about the genetic basis of race is to hold the race concept up to data on the structure of human genetic variation. The fact that the race concept is a relatively recent historical development bound to a particular cultural context has no bearing on whether it's a good approximation of reality. The claim that the Earth orbits around the Sun is also a relatively recent development rooted in particular historical circumstances. That doesn't mean that the claim is false. Where I would push us to think, then, is in a more complex way about the origins of biological differences among racially defined groups, ranging from the molecular to the global, in ways that we can understand how systemic racism gets embodied under the skin and produces the very biological differences that are our concern. Thank you. Yes, I'd be happy to entertain questions, comments, feedback, criticism, any of that. Yes.
Wonderful talk, so well presented. And I have just really an understanding question from the first half of the talk, where you described the Puerto Rican categories of color and how from that you can see that indeed those are correlated with problems of blood pressure. But then you use those categories to actually reveal the allele, or at least the alleles that were responsible, the pathways through which the hypertension is working. What does that tell us about the article? You know, I'm thinking about that. If you could explain that a little bit more. The article that said, well, you know, the results are suggestive of genetic differences, and you were saying, well, that's not really true at all because they weren't suggestive of it. How is it that I still don't quite grasp how it is that, you know, using the cultural classification system to get at the causative factors or the correlation factors, that enables you to get to the allelic factors that underlie it, and why that then doesn't constitute evidence of genetic correlation, or does it? Maybe I just didn't understand.
So I think the key point is that that analysis does show that at an individual level, your genetic makeup has a bearing on your risk of high blood pressure. But the genes that are involved are not distributed along the lines of race or along the lines of color. Okay. So the reason that we were able to see that is that in the analysis that ignored the sociocultural variables, whatever genetic effect was there, because it's a small
effect.
Okay,
so it's stripping away the cultural variables.
Basically, think about it as saying, okay, we've now accounted for all of these other environmental factors that also affect blood pressure. And when you strip that away, then you can see that our power to detect a genetic association increases.
Okay, I got it.
And so I think the key, just to emphasize again, is that I'm not making an argument that genes are irrelevant. Mm-hmm. I'm making an argument that if we try to understand human biology and genetic variation in particular through the lens of race, we'll get it wrong. And if by contrast we take seriously our claim that race is a social construct and we measure ways that it is constructed and how it affects people's lives, then we are probably going to be empowered to detect genetic associations that are non-racial in a better way.
Good, thanks.
Yes?
I was very interested in your network study because it seemed to not allude to strong differences between men and women in the strength and influence of their social networks. And it's hard for me to believe that would be unmediated by gender roles.
I'm sorry that I gave that impression. Because I think that you're right. I think that the experience of those networks, and I think, moreover, I think the experience of vicarious racism is very likely to be gendered. We have only just begun to analyze the network data in particular. So today I was only presenting the results from that simple survey question when we ask about you or someone close to you. But we're definitely going to be looking for those kind of gendered effects in the analysis of vicarious racism in the networks. Yes?
Thanks for a great talk. I have sort of terminological questions that I wanted to ask you about, and one of them has to do with how you framed the end in terms of culture v. biology, and I was wondering why you're using cultural, race as a cultural construct rather than race as a social construct, and how you see those as potentially different or not. And then the other thing that, the other sort of terminological question I had is from the beginning of your talk, to ask you, you know, what it means for other researchers or for you to say African genetic ancestry, African as a
super,
you know,
problematic.
Well, it's used all the time,
yeah.
And it seems quite meaningless to me in many ways, since that would actually include the ancestry of the entire Earth's population. So, you know, why use it as a term, or what work do you think it does to use it?
Let me address that one first, and then I'll come back to the other one. I anticipated this criticism in my sort of throwaway line about there are a whole bunch of problematic assumptions
built into
this ancestry informative markers. And I would agree with you that terminology itself becomes a vehicle for a lot of essentialist thinking. So I'm critical of it in that way, but my intent, the way that I'm trying to use it, is to capture the attention of human geneticists and biomedical researchers who use it routinely, and to say, this notion is so mistaken that when we do it, but we also take account of the sociocultural reality of race and racism, that there's nothing there. And we've done this now in Puerto Rico and in the United States with at least four different papers where we've applied this approach and showed that if you take account of the sociocultural variables as well, the thing just goes away. So what I'm hoping to do is to sort of co-opt the discourse that's happening in human genetics and in some parts of biomedical research and demonstrate that we can actually do it better, that we can show that other factors really matter. And I think it's useful at the same time to sort of maintain the critique of the assumptions that are built into those calculations in the first place.
But what do you think it means to the researchers you're talking about? When they're using that term African genetic ancestry, are they actually talking about sub-Saharan African people in Africa, or are they talking about any black people anywhere? Or, you know, like, what are they thinking?
I can't wait to read that ethnography. But I think that based on my interactions with researchers in that area, and based on the things that I read, I think that many researchers who deploy that idea really are thinking of it in essentialist terms, like there's some essence of Africanness that is unique and is carried through the African diaspora. So in sub-Saharan Africa, especially West Africa, and also to the descendants of slaves in the Americas. Part of what is extra problematic is that those estimates are often derived by comparing African Americans or anyone in the Americas to genetic databases from a single population, the Yoruba, where the Yoruba then come to stand for Africanness. So that's where these essentialist ideas are super problematic. And the same thing happens where European is represented by a small sample of white Mormons in Utah, and Asian is represented by samples from Han Chinese. So it's the typological assumptions are built into the estimates to begin with. And so it's really not surprising that they don't actually predict the outcomes that we care about. What they are picking up in the studies that use them is they're picking up the sociocultural implications of being racialized in that way in a racist society. So in every case where we've tried so far, when we try, even with really crude measures like years of education, to get at some of those mechanisms, the ancestry effect proves to be extremely fragile, and it goes away.
Yeah.
So the other question was about why am I framing race as a cultural construct rather than as a social construct? I do both, and the reason is that in some ways I'm a very old-fashioned anthropologist. I like the culture concept still, and I, in particular, I use a concept of culture derived from cognitive anthropology, in which culture consists of shared, socially transmitted understandings about how the world works, and race is one of those. What Smedley referred to as the racial worldview is, we could understand it as a cultural model in those cognitive terms. But as the analysis that I presented suggests, I understand that that cultural meaning is itself socially constructed. It emerges from social interaction and from the embeddedness of people in social institutions. So it's a cultural construct that's socially constructed, if that makes sense. Thank you for helping me think that through. Did you have a question?
I did.
Okay.
I have a question that's also about terminology, and that is, what is an African American? And when you use that, do you mean that your study includes a particular population that has a certain history, or is it a polite way of just saying anyone who happened to be black in Tallahassee at the time? I'm just curious about that.
Yeah. My community partners and I spent a long time sitting around the table trying to deal with that issue, so I appreciate you raising it. In our particular case, what it meant operationally was that people had to identify themselves as either African American or black, and they had to have been born in the United States. So, and this was especially important in a place like Tallahassee, because it is the home of FAMU. One of the largest, if not the largest, it seems to vary from one year to the other, one of the largest HBCUs in the country. It also becomes a meeting place for the African diaspora. There are many Afro-Caribbeans and Africans there as well. And we reasoned that the experience of blackness would be sufficiently different for people, depending on whether they had grown up in the United States or not, that we wanted to limit our scope there. But I think that there's plenty of other evidence out there to suggest the importance of exploring beyond that category and exploring more in a richer way the diversity of ways that people experience blackness from the Caribbean to Africa to the US. I would mention just briefly along these lines, in case you don't know about it already, work by, I'm getting old enough now that sometimes I blank on names. It's not just you, Kevin. Collins and David, James Collins and Richard David, they have done work looking at birth outcomes in Illinois. And they did this amazing study where they collected data on all births in the state of Illinois for U.S.-born whites, U.S.-born blacks, and African immigrants. And they showed that the distribution of birth weight for African immigrants mirrored perfectly the distribution of birth weight for U.S.-born whites. But that U.S.-born blacks, the distribution was shifted down towards lower birth weights. So just that result on the face of it undermines any real assumption that there is some intrinsic racial genetic difference here, because in fact the U.S.-born whites and the African immigrants looked the same. But where the study got even more compelling is that they then followed the next generation of kids, and that first generation of kids that had been born in the U.S. to parents who were African immigrants, that birth distribution in a single generation shifted down to match that of the U.S.-born white, U.S.-born blacks in the original study, which for most of you are anthropologists in the room, makes me think back to Franz Boas's demonstration as well of how within a single generation the American environment could shape development of these phenotypes. And for me, that's a very compelling case that it's not about African ancestry. It's about the toxic effects of living in a society where you are defined as black.
While we're giving out references, I should mention that our colleague who's leaving us, Grace Cao, not enough people know her result, which is the same thing for IQ of Chinese immigrants coming to the United States, that the difference between their vaunted difference, higher IQs washes out after a generation. So it's a really interesting set of results to think about.
For sure. Yeah, I appreciate that link as well for the way that it, my discussion is focused very clearly on black-white differences, both because in terms of public health, that's where it matters most, I would argue, but also because of the historical depth of that particular contrast in our society and in the origins of American medicine. But I appreciate you pointing out that other racialized populations with other kinds of outcomes may experience similar dynamics. Was that a hand I could?
It wasn't a hand, but you can go first.
Okay.
Well, I want to talk a little bit, go back to the issue about genetic variation in human populations, which you have critiqued in a specific kind of way. But and in some cases, the study themselves are the ones that create confusion or make assumptions about the samples that they have. But we do have an increasingly clearer and clearer picture of the structure of human variation across the world, the relative evolutionary historical influences which have shaped this. And so, and that includes individuals with African ancestry, that is, continental ancestry from that place, whether it's North Africa to South Africa. So, do you think that if you, and I think the way you're framing it in terms of the interaction between gene and environment is quite right, but do you think that with, and also once you have the relationship between SEA other variables which actually affect relative things that impinge upon the biology, you're getting at aspects of genetics which actually may be important from a very specific treatment or intervention standpoint. But do you think that if we enlarge our understanding of African ancestry from a genetic standpoint, have a more clear picture of this in relation to various kinds of disease studies, that we'll be actually able to identify other specific mechanisms or pathways which would actually allow us to see why differences may occur, even considering the other sorts of social cultural variables which actually may have a very significant effect on health outcomes for people with African descent?
There's a lot there. Okay. So the first thing I would say is that it's true that we have finer and finer resolution of the structure of genetic variation in our species. And it does allow us to identify clusters of genetic similarity that allow an evolutionary explanation, whether it's due to selection or more often drift because of populations that have been isolated by oceans or the Himalayas or that kind of thing. So that is true. Yet, I would still resist an effort to link those clusters to races. It's still not race. And also, I think that the magnitude of those differences is completely consistent with the critique of race that anthropologists have advanced for the last century. No one has ever said there's no variation in our species. Well, maybe people have said that. But the serious critics of race, as I understand it, have not made the claim that there is no variation. And in fact, you think about Richard Lewontin's famous study, which says that most of the variation is within populations among individuals. But he never said all of the variation is. You know, he still allowed, depending on which of the subsequent studies you look at, 5 to 15% of it is structured at a higher level of population. So the reason I mention that is that I don't get too worked up about the fact that we have the resolution to identify those clusters now, because the critique of race, as we've always advanced it, would have predicted exactly that. That is, the technology got better, we would be able to identify those clusters. And that's fine. So Now, the other thing is, what do those differences mean where they exist? And by and large, the pattern, as I understand this literature, not being a geneticist, just hanging out with them sometimes, is that the genetic markers that we use to create those clusters or to recognize that structure in the population as a rule, don't have any functional effect on biological outcomes that we care about. They seem to be mostly neutral markers that basically represents reproductive isolation and drift. But when we get down to explaining why it is that for almost every outcome that we look at, there are inequalities among racially defined groups in the US, I think as a rule, the genes are not going to help us understand those inequalities at all, or in a very minuscule way if they do. And this is why I cite the systematic review by Jay Kaufman and his colleagues, which says that, you know, you think about the range of studies, all these big genome-wide association studies have been done now looking for the genetic contributors, and there's basically nothing there. And I don't think that that situation is fundamentally going to change. Did I address your question?
We can talk more about it. But,
I feel like
as you get into genomic levels, you're talking about markers which have functional consequences. There are two different ways in which this could actually, you could make it more complex in very interesting ways. The one is the fact that much with genome sequences, we go beyond the neutral markers to those which actually have functional consequences. Those that occur in non-coding areas and non-coding RNAs, things like this, which actually can regulate gene expression, which are also inherited markers. So there's that part of which we now begin to get some sort of handle on, and they vary in some ways. We just don't know how, perhaps it's not been systematically analyzed, perhaps at a global scale. But then another thing that came to mind, which would actually lead directly into your work in a very, I think, a very interesting way, would be the epigenetic dimension of experience and how that gets transmitted both on an individual basis, accumulates obviously, but also back with the generation. But I think basically as we look at the genome not as a, you're going from this very simple Mendelian calculus of a DNA to an RNA to a protein to something that's much more complex, and we do move beyond, well beyond any kind of typological understanding of genetics and the one-to-one correlation between a marker and an outcome. Phenotype is much more, have to be defined much more complexly at both biological as well as social and cultural levels now. And that's the task for trying to interrelate those sets of data.
I would endorse the idea that we need to think of biology as more complex and move beyond that simple genetic model of genetic determinism. In practice, though, I don't see that happening. In practice, there are very few studies that treat the genetic and sociocultural contributors to disease or complex phenotypes with equal rigor. I mean, it almost never happens. And what's so dangerous is when notice that this model doesn't say, well, we shouldn't look at the genome. We should look at the genome, but the genome isn't structured in the way that we would predict by race. Genes matter, but not in a racial way. They matter at the individual family level, maybe in some cases a population level, but not race. So what I would say is, if you have a genetic hypothesis, you need to collect genetic data. And this seems like a pretty bare-bones request, but it's stunning how often research gets published that advances a genetic explanation for racial inequalities in some disease, and the study includes no genetic data at all. So what my argument would be, test competing hypotheses with equal rigor. And if you're testing a genetic hypothesis about the basis for some racial inequality in disease, then you should make sure that you are also attempting to measure the way that biology is impacted by living in a systemically racist society. Yes, in the back?
Your talk, I really enjoyed your to paint that picture a little bit more messy, especially for the way in which you talked about the social or public determinants of health, with race, and biology as well. That's what I'm coming from. Separating the biological and the social, I'm not sure.
Yeah, that's a good point. So some of the messiness is intended to be captured with this very thin line that runs. So perhaps I need to write a follow-up paper about unpacking that little box and that line. But yeah, that's an interesting observation that still I have the social and the biological on extreme sides. Yeah, I mean, I've also depicted only one of these directions, but it goes the other way as well, particularly in this domain of the health disparities research, because structured inequalities in society produce biological outcomes, but then those biological differences get used to legitimate the concept of race first place. So in the paper from which this comes, How Race Becomes Biology, I really mean to be arguing that race becomes biology in two ways. It becomes embodied in biological outcomes, but then it also, because of those embodied differences, reinforce folk views of race as biology. And so there is that feedback in both ways. The part of the difficulty, as I'm pondering how to address your suggestion, is that, you know, in my work, I don't just consider anthropologists as my audience. And anthropologists like it when it gets messy, but not all of our colleagues in other disciplines do. And so there's a balance that we have to strike between pushing science toward more complexity, and also recognize that every model is a simplification of reality and needing to reach that audience in some way. But yeah, it's a thoughtful, I appreciate that suggestion. Yes?
So I'm just gonna make you be messy again, I guess. But especially in the context of some of the other talks we've heard in this colloquium series, I'm curious that it seems like you have the potential to have some data that allows you to speak about the differences between your own perception of your race and other people's perception of your race. And you talked about this explicitly at a few points during the talk, but then I think that in the presentation of the results, some of those things got muddled again. And I was curious if you could just talk a little bit about, you know, if you see, especially in this vicarious racism concept that you've developed, if you see a difference between how you identify racially versus how people in the society in which you exist identify you.
So yes to all of that. I'm totally on board with all of it. The simplification that you saw was a result of my attempt to tell you what I've been doing for the last 15 years in 45 minutes. I still didn't make it to 45. So just a couple of thoughts in response. One is that I have another paper that I didn't talk about here that looks directly at the incongruity between how you identify yourself and how you are perceived by others. And this is a paper that Bill Dressler and I did in 2005 in the American Journal of Human Biology, where I took measures of phenotype of skin pigmentation. And I'd also asked people to rate themselves on a 9-point scale from light to dark. And I noticed during those interviews that there was often a real disconnect between those. And so in that particular paper, what we show is that we constructed a measure for the extent to which people deviated in their own self-perception from what you might expect based on their pigmentation. And we found that people who evaluated themselves as lighter than you would expect on the basis of pigmentation also have the highest blood pressure if they lived in middle-class neighborhoods. So those people who were climbing the social ladder, and consequently, you know, this Latin American idea that money whitens, we saw that basically that was happening to them. They had higher incomes, higher education. They perceived themselves as más claro, as lighter, But presumably, they were received by others on the basis of what people saw. And so the stress of bumping up against that results in high blood pressure. So that's one thought about it. And yeah, in the work in Puerto Rico, we measure race whole tons of different ways. And there's also some really fascinating work by the sociologist Elias Saperstein on this work. She and her colleagues have been looking at multiple dimensions of race, self-identified, identified by others, and they've linked it with some of the work in health as well. They did a fascinating paper showing that coroners' identification of deceased people's race was influenced by the cause of death. So that if people died from heart disease, the coroners, on average, were more likely to say that they were black. And if they died, if the deceased person died from cirrhosis, they were, other things being equal, more likely to say that the deceased person was Native American. So even some of the evidence about the magnitude of these inequalities, the assumptions about race are cooked into it in the first place. Okay, the last thing you asked was about vicarious racism and whether how people identify themselves or perceived by others matters. And I think that it almost surely does. The way that we will be able to look at that in our study is that in addition to measures of vicarious racism and all the health outcomes, we also used a pretty standard measure of black racial identity that was developed by social psychologists, the multidimensional inventory of black identity, it's called. And it has subscales for what they call centrality, public regard, and private regard. And the centrality is basically like how important is your black identity to you, to your sense of who you are. The public regard is a measure of how you think other people out there in the society perceive blacks. And the private regard is how people in your own life sort of perceive blacks. And I would anticipate, I'm going on record here now specifying my hypothesis, that there will be an interaction between those measures of identity and vicarious racism, so that people for whom their racial identity is more important are likely to be more sensitive to that exposure than would be people who, for whom their identity as a black person is not as central to their conception of self. So, what I really love about this is that you all have already given me an idea for like 6 papers I need to go and write right now.
Excellent.
Yeah.
I think we have time for one more. If there's one more question, we can take it.
Okay.
I wonder if, the last few, the question and your answer led to, and then the previous work in Puerto Rico, as well as Marco Dresser does in Brazil, all the places looking at identity as measured through faith of creation. I wonder how, given the diversity of peoples who live in Africa, I wonder how this might actually be interested in sort of exploring through other sorts of vectors like religion. As opposed to, say, something along the Islamic education, other things which have this cross-sect, phenotypic variability, which may lead to SES, which may also lead to other kinds of either identities so that they create buffers relative to other sorts of perturbations or social facts that impinge on their lives versus other which may lead to greater vulnerabilities. If you thought about trying to maybe adding this sort of little vector or dimension to some of these sorts of analyses in certain places, it would allow us to unpack more complexity of social experience and impact on lived experience vis-a-vis biology.
Yeah, so I think you're right to be pushing in that direction. So the last couple of times that I have presented about this idea of vicarious racism, I've had at least one person come up to me after every one of those talks to say, you know, I was thinking as you were talking that this would also apply to vicarious other isms, you know, any other form of stigma and social exclusion. it's not unique to the experience of racism. And so I think for any other axis of social stratification, any other form of oppression, that this, both the intersection of multiple forms of oppression would matter, but also expanding our view beyond the individual to what's happening around you. I think both of those things need to happen. Yeah, I feel like I should just start like making this like, you know, super messy like this.
Great, well with that.